it does not carry. Because if you see some other federal constitutions, the expression union is used very liberally, irrespective of whether the constitution is the result of an agreement between sovereign states or not, or whether there is a right of secession vested in the states or not. For example, United States, which is an instance of a classical federalism, and the American constitution was formed by way of an agreement, you know, that Philadelphia Convention. But the American preamble of the American constitution also uses the expression union, you know, we the people of United States of America, in order to make it more perfect union. So I don't think that any psychological impact is created by the expression union. Maybe the Constituent Assembly wanted to impress upon the fact that it was indestructible union with destructible state, you know, that is again a unitary feature. I'll come to that later. So and then if you see the constitution of the erstwhile USSR, now it is fragmented, Article 17 of USSR constitution guaranteed the right of secession, and that constitution also used the expression union. So the reason cited by the drafting committee for using expression union and not federation are not convincing. Anyways, the second most important feature which makes Indian constitution quasi federal is power of the parliament to redraw the political map of India. You know, Article 2 and 3 give the power to Union Parliament to create or abolish the states, change the boundaries of the states, or even change their names. And this can be achieved by way of a simple legislation made with simple majority. And the constitutional provisions only provide for consultation by the center with the concerned state. You know, before Andhra Pradesh was divided recently into Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, the Andhra Pradesh Assembly had passed a resolution opposing any such proposal to divide the state. Irrespective of that, the central government went ahead with the law to create state of Telangana as a 29th state under the Indian Union. So what the provision provides is consultation, not concurrence. And the president can only prescribe a time frame within which the state assembly has to take a call on the proposal of the central government to either divide the existing state or merge two or more states and create a new state. You know, three new states had been created during the earlier regime, tenure of the NDA government under Vajpayee's leadership: Uttarakhand, Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh. And then subsequently, in 2007, I think, if I am not wrong, the name of Uttaranchal was changed to Uttarakhand. So, and this can be achieved without amending constitution. There is no requirement for amending the constitution. So, central government has upper hand so far as the creation or abolition of the states are concerned. Of course, the Constituent Assembly had its own reasons to provide for such mechanism. Because if you see the historical background, under the British India, the provinces, they were mostly organized on political considerations and administrative convenience. And these provinces did not satisfy the regional aspirations, specifically the linguistic aspirations of the people. Now, Constituent Assembly was supposed to solve this problem, which it did not. And Constituent Assembly left it to the discretion of the Union Parliament to solve this problem as and when such demands were made, without taking recourse to the difficult process of amendment of the constitution. So that's why they did not provide for the requirement of amendment. And you know, in 1953, the first linguistic state was formed. And you know, ironically, it was Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh was the first state which was formed on the basis of language. There was a political activist, Sri Ramalu, who died in a hunger strike demanding the separate state for Telugu speaking people. Now same Andhra Pradesh has now been divided into two states on some other ground, that is, you know, development, that Telangana remained underdeveloped as compared to the coastal Andhra and the Rayalaseema. So now it is again divided, but most of these states were created under the States Reorganization Act 1956, and then subsequently also Parliament enacted laws and created states on the basis of language, cultural identity, developmental issues, etc. So this is a quasi-federal feature. And then I have already mentioned that there is no equal representation to the states in Rajya Sabha. Even the value of the vote casted by the MLAs in presidential election changes from state to state. It depends on the population of the state. Then the fourth most important and controversial aspect of Indian federalism is that the governors, state governors, are appointed and removed by the central government. The governor is a constitutional head of the state, and at the same time he is also representative of the center, because central government is duty bound under Article 355 to ensure that there is no failure of constitutional machinery in the state, and the states are protected from internal disturbance and external aggression or war. So in order to enforce that duty, the central government has power under 356 to impose president's rule, and it is the governor who makes the report to the center whenever there is a failure of constitutional machinery for political or otherwise reasons. And governor, unlike president, enjoys certain discretionary powers. The most important is power to reserve certain bills for the consideration of the president. There was a controversy. The Gujarat Assembly has passed Gujcock. It is popularly called as Gujcock. It's a anti-terrorism legislation. And earlier, this legislation was blocked by the state governor when UPA was ruling in the center. Kamala Benival was the governor, and she blocked it, and then she reserved it for the assent of the president, and president declined the assent. President, of course, is bound to act in accordance with the aid and advice of the Union Council of Minister. And the political complexion was different because Congress party was ruling in the center, and Modi's government, it was a BJP government. And that is why when Modi assumed power, he immediately transferred Kamala Benival, who was a very old lady, to Mizoram. And she reluctantly joined as governor, and subsequently she was sacked. So governors are appointed and removed on political grounds, and governor is supposed to be apolitical, and governor is supposed to be a man includes woman, of wisdom, experience and character. But what do we see? Governors are appointed from the rank and file of the political parties. Who get appointed as governors? Party loyalists, or they are called as party pensioners. Those who have served political parties for a long time, they get the reward in the form of governor's position. Currently, if you have a look at the governors appointed by this NDA government, recently 8 governors appointed during UPA's time, they were asked to resign, including Sheila Dixit, who was governor of Kerala, and 2 were sacked. Aziz Qureshi, again Mizoram. Mizoram has seen, I think, 5 or 6 governors in last 1 year. So earlier Shankar Narayan, who was the governor of Maharashtra, was asked to go to Mizoram. He refused and resigned. So Ram Naik is governor of Uttar Pradesh. He's a veteran BJP politician from state of Maharashtra. Kalyan Singh, who was convicted by Supreme Court and sent to 1 day imprisonment for contempt of court when Babri mosque was demolished under his chief ministership, he is also, I think, governor in one of the states. And not only the current government, even the earlier governments used to appoint the persons belonging to the ruling party in the center. For example, Sushil Kumar Shinde was the governor. I think Motilal Vora, then Surjit Singh Barnala. There are ample examples. And recently there was a controversy when the former Chief Justice of India, Sadashivam, was appointed as governor of Kerala. Congress party alleged that what pleased the NDA government so as to appoint him as governor, you know. And then even the Supreme Court Bar Association, Kerala Bar Association criticized the appointment of the former Chief Justice as the governor of state, because according to them, it is not, it is a political and constitutional impropriety. It would gravely undermine and abrogate the independence of judiciary, because then it becomes a tool in the hand of the central government or the ruling party to woo the judges who are about to retire. And you know, there may be quid pro quo, you know, I don't know. We cannot say that there was quid pro quo, because Justice Sadashivam seems to be a very honest judge. But criticism was made when he was appointed as governor, because as a Chief Justice of India, he administered oath to the President of India. Now he is reporting to the same person, the President. So this post of the governor is very controversial post. See, in other federal states, this problem is not there, because states have their own constitutions. Now, for example, in United States, the states have their own constitution, so governors are mostly elected by people. Now, when our constitution was being framed, the political advisor to the Constituent Assembly, Dr. B.N. Rao, he proposed that the governor should be elected by the provincial legislature, state legislature. Then when subsequently the drafting committee submitted the first draft to the President of the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, there were two alternatives provided. One, that the governor should be appointed by the President, that is central government, from the panel of four elected by the state legislature. Second alternative was that the governor should be elected by the people of the province or the state. Now, why the second alternative was not preferred? Yes. See, if the governor is, if the governor is elected by the people, then he might arrogate the political power to himself. You know, if you have a mechanism where both governor and chief minister are elected by people, the governor will be elected by the entire population of the state, as against the chief minister, who would be representing a small constituency, which would be a very small part of the territory of the state. So the Constituent Assembly thoroughly debated the merits and demerits of the elected and nominated governor, and they finally preferred the nomination of the governor by the central government, because this was consistent with the policy adopted by the Constituent Assembly of India, because the policy was bias in favor of the centralization, inbuilt bias, you know, unitary spirit. So in furtherance of that unitary spirit, the institution of the governor was created. So it was thought that the governor elected by the direct vote of the people would be a party man, and governor is supposed to be a detached figure, preferably from outside the state. So he should not be you know, closely connected with the local politics. So that was one reason. Then subsequently, Sarkaria Commission, which studied the center-state relation, made certain recommendations, because there was no effective consultation by the central government with the chief ministers of the states when governors were appointed. So it was recommended that the governor should be some eminent person in some walk of life. But you know, recently there was a controversy, I think during UPS time 2013, Ashwini Kumar, who is the former CBI director, was appointed as governor, and BJP, then opposition party, criticized it, and this criticism was particularly important in the context of Supreme Court's remarks that CBI is a caste parrot. You know, CBI has been called as caste parrot by the Supreme Court. So we don't know whether there was quid pro quo or not, but if you see the background, Ashwini Kumar was CBI director and CBI officer when you know, he was responsible for the security of Sonia Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi. And then it was also brought to the notice of the